Hi guys, and welcome to OGLDEV. My name is Itai Meiri. So we've got the translation, and we've got rotation, time form, exactly, scaling. And the idea here is very simple. You take a model from somewhere, you load it into your 3D world, and it looks a bit small. So you apply the scaling transformation in order to scale it up to make it bigger. And it works also the other way around. You can take a big object and apply the scaling transformation, which will scale it down again. And you can render the same object multiple times using different matrices with different sizes. Now, I know what you're saying, it's not exactly the same, but just imagine that they are, okay? So now let's get serious and talk about the math and the code. But before I forget, since this is a fairly short topic, we're also going to discuss the combination of transformations and the ordering of transformations, so stay tuned. Let's take a look at an example of scaling. The idea here is to multiply one or more components of the position coordinates by an arbitrary factor. This, of course, must be done on all vertices of the mesh, so they all scale together. Here we have a square. Let's scale its x component by 2. This causes the square to become a rectangle that is stretched horizontally. If we scale its y component by 2, the rectangle is stretched vertically. When only one dimension is scaled, or when the scaling factor is different for each dimension, we call this non-uniform scaling. The original proportion of the object are lost in this case. If we scale both x and y by 2, we simply get a larger square. This is called uniform scaling, and it preserves the proportions of the object. In fact, the size of the surface of this square is 4x the size of the surface of the original square. If the scaling factor is greater than 1, the object becomes larger, and if it is less than 1 but greater than 0, the object becomes smaller. Also note that if the scaling factor is negative, the object flips. I usually don't do this, but you may want to experiment with that and see if it is useful to you. Let's develop the scaling transformation using a matrix. It's very simple. We take the identity matrix and we multiply it by the position vector. The result is obviously the same vector. Remember that we are doing a dot product of each row with the vector, and this produces the value in the resulting vector on the same row. Each row contains a single value of 1, which is in the diagonal. This causes the corresponding position element of the same row to end up in the result. The three other zeros on the same row eliminate the remaining position elements. So all we have to do is replace the value of 1 with the desired scaling factor for this position element. In general, we get the following matrix. SF is shorthand for scaling factor. If the three scaling factors are identical, this is a uniform scaling matrix. And if they are not identical, then this is a non-uniform scaling matrix. Now let's see how we can implement this in the code. Okay, so this code is pretty much identical to the one from the last two tutorials. When you check it out, you should see that we have in this render scene callback function, we have three functions here, the scaling example and two examples combining transformations. 1 and 2, so these two should be commented out, and this is what we're going to see right now. So let's go to this function, which is defined up there. We have the scale, we set the scale to 1, and we have a delta, which is set to 1/100, and on each call to the render callback, we add the delta to the scale. So when the scale crosses 1.5, or when it goes below 1/2, we change the direction by multiplying delta with -1. And we create a uniform scaling matrix, same as we saw in the diagram. We have the same value scale, which changes on each call along the diagonal. And we provide the address of the scaling matrix here. We've seen this before, the call to GL uniform matrix 4FV. If you don't remember, just go to the last two tutorials. So this makes the matrix go to the shader, and the vertex shader itself also remains the same. Let's just take a quick look. I've just renamed the uniform variable to BG scaling to fit this this example, and then we multiply it again on the left hand side of the position vector. Okay, so now let's build and run this. Okay, and we can see that the triangle scales up to be 50% larger than the original and 50% smaller. So this is an example of uniform scaling. Okay, so the next topic is the combination of transformations, and the reason that this interests us is that in many cases we want the object to be scaled, rotated, and then translated. This means that we have three matrices, one for each transformation, and we want to apply them one by one on the position vector. This may look something like that. Remember that we construct our matrices in a way that they must be multiplied on the left-hand side of the vector. After multiplying the scaling matrix by the vector, we get a scaled position. Then we multiply by the rotation matrix, so we get a rotated scaled position. And finally, after multiplying by the translation matrix, we get a translated, rotated, and scaled position. As we shall soon see, the order of multiplication is critical here. But before we do that, let's use a linear algebra law called the associativity of matrix multiplication. This law tells us that when we multiply three or more matrices, the placement of parentheses, as we can see in the example here, doesn't change the final result. This is important to us from a performance viewpoint. This law tells us that we don't need to provide multiple matrices to the shader and apply them one by one on each vertex. We can multiply them once in the application code and simply provide the result of the multiplication to the shader. So the shader only performs a single matrix multiplication, regardless of the number of actual transformations that are taking place. Another linear algebra law tells us that matrix multiplication is non-commutative. This means that if we change the order in which we multiply our matrices, we may get a different result. So the order is critical in terms of what we are trying to achieve. Let's see a simple example. In this spreadsheet, I created two matrices, a translation matrix here that translates the position by one on the x-axis, and a scaling matrix that scales all the dimensions by two right here. And then let's see what happens when we multiply first translation by scaling, or we change the order and multiply scaling by translation. So in order to do that, this is a Google Sheet document. So there is this function mmult. So you don't need to implement matrix multiplication yourself. You just need to use this mmult function and give it the two matrices. So here we can see in this case, first we have the translation matrix and then the scaling matrix, and the result simply a combination of the two matrices. So we have the scaling here and the translation here. What will happen is that we will, for example, for the x-axis, we will multiply it by 2 and then add a 1. And you will be able to see that if you just follow up on the dot product between this row and the position vector. And if we do this the other way around, so here we have first the scaling matrix and then the translation matrix, and suddenly we see that we're getting here 2 here, and that's because of the different order. Again, if you're not sure, just you can just try to multiply it by hand and you'll see the result. So this is definitely not what we intended. Okay, so if we do this the other way around, the result is unexpected. The object moves by 2 on the x-axis rather than 1. For the next example, let's comment out scaling example and comment in combining transformations example, which is defined right up here. Here we set the scale to 1.5. And we create a uniform scaling matrix. We define a location variable that starts at 0 and The delta is again 100th, and we add the delta on every call. So when it crosses a half, or it is less than minus a half, we reverse the direction. And we initialize the translation matrix using the location variable here to translate the object, the triangle, on the x-axis. And we create the final transformation matrix by multiplying translation by scaling. Okay, so I have the implementation of the multiplication operator in the OGLDEV math 3D.h. Here we have the implementation of the multiplication operator. This operates on the matrix on the left-hand side, and we provide the matrix on the right-hand side as a parameter. And this is a simple implementation of matrix multiplication. If you're not familiar with this, let me know. I can do a more in-depth tutorial on matrix multiplication. And we initialize the result in this matrix 4F ret variable, which is returned back to the caller. And if we run this like that, and notice how far the triangle goes on each side. Okay, keep that in mind, because now we're going to change the order. Now let's perform the translation first, because it is on the right hand side. Remember that we have the shader multiplies the result of this multiplication by the position vector, which is on the right hand side. So first translation, and then scaling. And now you can see that it goes further on both sides, much further than the original half. For the last example, I actually changed the size of the window to be square. We can see right here, the width and the height are identical. And the reason is that I wanted to avoid some confusion regarding the rasterizer, because the rasterizer works in a normalized box, right? It goes from -1, -1 up to 1 by 1. And if we have a regular non-square window and we don't take care of the aspect ratio, then things may look a bit distorted, especially in this example. We'll need to take care of this aspect ratio when we get to the perspective projection, but for now I think that a square will work better for us. So let's comment out this example and comment in the second combining transformation example, which is also defined here. And what we do here is that we're scaling, we're already familiar with this, so let's make this quick. We're scaling the triangle to be 1/4 on all dimensions, so we'll get a better view of it. Here we have a rotation matrix. So what we're doing here, by adding the delta to the angle in radians, we make the triangle constantly spin on one direction. And for the translation, as before, we're moving it by a half on the x-axis, right here. Okay, we have two examples here. In both of them, the scaling is on the right-hand side. So first of all, we scale the triangle down. And in the first example, we perform the rotation followed by translation. Okay, so take a moment, try to figure out what is going to happen. Now let's build and run this. Okay, so the triangle will scale down and then rotated and then move to the side, which now makes it spin around itself, as we can see here. Okay, and let's change the order. Here we have another example. Again, we're scaling the triangle down, and then we translate it, and then we rotate it. So the difference is very clear. Now the triangle spins around the center, because first it was moved to the right-hand side and then rotated. So that's it for the three major transformations. We're actually going to see them again when we get to the topic of camera control. In the next episode, we're going to talk about interpolation, which is also a very interesting topic. Let me know what you think in the comments below, if you have any questions or requests for additional stuff you want to learn about. Thank you for watching, and I will see you soon.